Welcome back to the channel. In today's video, I want to work with you to show you how to build a Gutenberg block. Now, from the time the WordPress 5.0 version was released, we've had things like these little blocks that you can actually pick from your holding area here. You drag them, you drop them, you can use them, you can edit the content, you can actually right click, you can delete them, and they make writing a little bit easier. Now, one of the things that we've been doing as people who make custom websites is doing things that are good in design. For example, if I came up with a complex design like this, this would make a perfect candidate for a block. And this is simply because we have this one block, which is a day one, this is day two, this is day three. They have content that is repetitive, but they have some little information that's changing in different areas with a little image that's also dynamic. Now, building this traditionally with a custom post type and being so many things brings about a bunch of headache altogether. So what I'm going to do is build this into a block, and then we can reuse it on a page and see how easy that is. Now, I will do this as a native block in the next video that I release about blocks, but in today's video I'm going to show you how to do this with advanced custom fields. And the reason is ACF is just great. It makes building these blocks really, really easy and so fast. So if you are interested in watching me build a block with ACF, then this is the video for you. Otherwise, let's jump into the actual building of our block. Now, the first step to building this block using ACF, of course, is to go back into the plugins territory, and we'll find that I have Advanced Custom Fields Pro already installed here, and I'm going to activate it. Let me say this, you cannot build blocks with ACF if you do not have the Pro version. So please watch out for the version that you have. If not, you can actually go and purchase this for a very small price, and you'll be able to use it and all the features that are involved. Now, we need to go into the custom fields area, and this is just like what you have in the free version, and we are going to create some field groups. Now, what we shall do here is we're going to set block. I'll call this the Travel Itinerary Block, and that's the name of our block. This block is going to have a number of items. So let me reduce this so that we can see the fields that we actually need. So this is going to be dynamic. So we need a title for our one block. So we need to have the time, or I'll say day stroke time. And then this will be automatically filled. If I don't have anything added here, it will be a text. And I'll add instruction and say insert, for example, day one. And then I'll say this is required because we need to have it. We don't have a placeholder, but I can also add a default value so that if someone forgets, that can be added, and then they will always be able to change that if they see that something is a mess. So we have the daytime already involved. I'll close that field. I'm going to add a new field, and inside here I need to add an image. So I'll say image. It will have a field of image, and then that's where we shall add the image. We can always just have either the image URL, or we can add the image array so that we can get all the information about the image itself. So we can always get this. And then I'll add a new field right here, but let me close this. Now in this new field, I'm actually going to add a title of what we are having here. So I'll say title of the day's activity, or day's activity title. So I'll cut this, make it easier to read. Day's activity title, I'll leave that as that. I'll remove this space and this underscore. This will be a text as well. I'll say it can either be required or not. I'll leave it as that. I'll close this field, and then we shall create a new field here. We're going to have the stuff like AM. So we'll have the AM description. It will be a text as well. It will not be required because sometimes we have an AM or we don't have it. So I'm going to close this and then I'll duplicate it so that we can have a PM as well. So we'll have PM description. I'll change this to PM. I'll leave this as a text and then close this field as well. And then I'm going to open up an overnight. That will be a text as well. I'll close it. Now the next important part that I need to do is this area with breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So I can have different fields here showing me breakfast, lunch, dinner, but I'm going to use a different field altogether. So I'm going to say available service, and I'm not just going to use a true false in this case. I'm going to have something that's more like a group. I can either use a group or I can use a repeater. But for now, I'm going to use a group, and that's going to allow me to have another field group here. So I'm adding a field, which I'm going to say this is going to be breakfast. Our available service, of course, will be required because we need someone to know. So we'll have breakfast, which is going to be a true false. So the default will always be false. Someone needs to just turn it on. And then I'll close this field. I'll just duplicate it 2 times and then we can change this to lunch. It will be true false. And then I'll have this as dinner. And it will also be a true false. So I'll close these groups as well. And once I'm done with having this information that I need, I can go to the next part, which tells me show this field if, and this is the important part where we describe our particular block. So if we go here and say choose post type, pages, user, forms, and all of this, you'll see that we have an option here of saying block. So when I choose the block, you'll see that we don't have any blocks that are registered. So for now, I'm just going to save this data and publish it here. And then I'm going to first go and create my block. That's the next step that we need to do. So I'll open up my editor here and I'm going to go into the plugins. I'll create a new folder, which I'm going to call travel-block. And inside here is where I'll have our travel block, travel-block.php. Now, the reason I'm using a plugin is quite simple. With plugins, they handle how data is entered, how it's stored, and how we have it in different places so that in the event that we change our theme, we still have our data available. But if you put this block, which of course you can, in your theme, if the theme is changed in the future and we lose the data, we will be in trouble. So that's why I choose a plugin right now to know that even if the theme is changed, we'll still have this data showing up. So I'm going to start off with my PHP right here, and then I'll use my shortcode that will allow me to start the plugin, and then I'll just add here the travel itinerary block, and then I'll change this to my link that I'll have on GitHub, and of course my plugin author will be TechiePress. And then I'll just say this is the travel block. I'll add this here as well as the description. And then I'll change this to GPL2. And then of course, I'll just copy this and use this as a prefix or the text domain for my particular plugin. Of course, I'll add the simple security for my plugin as I always do and say, we either check to see that this plugin was loaded correctly through WordPress in the right channels by using apps path, or we just tell the person who is trying to hack our system that they have no authorized access. And once we do that, then we are ready to start registering our block. So the process of developing the block is actually well documented on the ACF website, and we're going to open up the blocks page right here. And in here, we'll actually get some code samples, and I'm just going to copy this code, then I'll explain what's going on. So I'll paste this here, and you're going to see that the first thing that happens is we have an action. And this action looks for this hook that comes from the ACF namespace. And it says if ACF has been initialized, then you run this function right here below. So I'm just going to do a little bit of changes here on this word my and add techie press. And then I'll change ACF and I'll say travel it block. And then I can just delete the rest of the parts that are here. And this will give us a good function name so that we don't have any other places where this is clashing. And the next thing we'll look at is that it checks for the function if the ACF register block type function actually exists. Now this function only exists in the ACF Pro version. If you have the free version, then this is not going to work at all. You're just going to get a message telling you to either install ACF Pro or that you can't use this plugin. So after doing that, we then register this method or this function, and this function takes in an array of information. And the first thing it does is that it takes in the name. Our name is going to be the travel it block. That will be the name. And then I'm going to change the name here that we'll see. I'll copy this and come back here and I'll change it as our title so that we'll see the block as that. And then I'll also change this description, add it here to add good information for traveler. And then the next thing that I will do is we need to have this render template right here, which is going to be a file that we shall add to our block. And if you don't use this template, you can actually use something that's called a render callback. So in here we can write render underscore callback, and then I'll map this onto maybe an anonymous function. So you can write a function here and then you can run this instead of having the template. So for now, let me comment out my template and let's use a function right here. So in this function, what I'll do is I'll say echo, and here we're going to say our ACF block. So I'll add an H3 and I'm going to say close this H3, and inside here we'll say our travel block. And that will allow us to see our block before we start doing so many crazy things to it. So I'm going to save this as that. We'll say the category we want to have this is in the formatting, or we can have it in the common, or we can have it in media. And I'm not getting those ideas and words out of my head. If I go back inside our, let's say a post here, and I open up this post, and I try to add a block, you'll see that we have these different categories. We have the texts, which are the common, we have the media, we have the design, we have the widgets, we have the embeds, and these are the categories that we can use: embeds, widgets, design, media, and texts. And for our particular block right here, I actually want to send it inside the media right here, because it will have an image, it will have a couple of things on it. So I'm going to come back here and I'll change this to media. And then the icon that it's going to use is going to be the format gallery. And I'm getting this from dash icons. And after that, the keywords that I want to use so that when someone comes in this space and types for gallery, for example, you'll see this shows up. I want to be able for someone to write travel, and then they'll be able to get that right here when they search. So I'm going to come back here, I'll say travel. I'll add itinerary as a word as well. Travel, itinerary, and you can add any other thing or even say techie press. So I'll add that. And also here, I'll save this. So on saving this, I'm going to go back to our plugin section. First and foremost, I'll go to plugins, and inside here you're going to see that we have this block here. I'm going to click activate right here, And after doing that, I'm going to go back to posts right here. I'll go to that post, and when I come here and click this and then try to look for the media, you will see we have the travel itinerary block right here. And if I click on it, you'll actually see that when it drops here, it echoes our particular text we added that says our travel block. And that's using the render callback here in this function. So I'm going to comment out this callback and allow us to use the template and see how that would look like. So inside our plugin here, I'm going to open up a new folder called template parts, and it will be for the blocks right here. So I'll copy this template parts, and this is not a must, but it's a good design pattern. I'm going to do the template parts because we can actually extend this and use themes to influence the way our templates should actually look. So inside here, I'm going to have our travel block. So I'll add a new file and call it travel-block.php. And the reason I do that is because we're actually going to have some HTML in here. So I'll say, let's comment this and say layout of our travel block. And that's just a comment to remind us what this file is actually doing. So I'll come back here, we're going to say travel, and I'm going to say travel dash block. If I use this, we shall actually have an issue because I have not properly linked this file to this render template. In this particular area, I'm actually just going to say, let's go and look for the plugin directory, and we want to get the path. And I'm going to say, look inside this file. And after looking inside this file, let's append it to this template parts. But if you look at this file, it is actually inside this travel block. So after getting to the travel block, we shall go into the template parts, and then we shall get into the travel block. So this is going to work very well. And inside here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to echo and say new travel block. And that's what we shall do in this part. And I realized I made a mistake right here by saying the plugin directory URL. We actually need the path because we need to embed an absolute path in this particular section. So I'll save this. I'm going to go back. I'll reload our browser here in our area for editing. And then I'll go to this location. And then when we see here, you'll see the travel block itinerary, which you can click to add here. And you'll see that all our fields actually show up in this section. So we can actually change the day one, we can add the day's activity title, we can see the AM, the PM, the overnight, and then we can check for the services we actually want to have. Now, these settings will affect this block once we add them to the block. But I realize these are very small boxes to do the descriptions for my AM, PM, and overnight. So I am going to actually stretch those out into a text area, and then I'll move the available service right under the day's activity title so that we can be able to have that showing up before it's overshadowed by all these other parts. So let's go back into the Fields Group Editor. And then I'll move the services just below day's activity. I'll edit the AM and change this into a text area. I'll change the PM as well. And then I'll change also the overnight into a text area. So once I've done that, I can then now come here and say update. So that when we come back to our block, let me just update this and reload our block here. You'll see that when I click on this travel block, we have this information that can actually be set in this particular section. Now, that's one of the beautiful things about ACF blocks, is that as you develop them and you do different things, they don't break the way native blocks actually do, because you're using JavaScript, and because you've changed it and compiled it, things sort of break along the way so easily. So that's one of the beautiful things of using ACF. Now I'm going to add day one here as information, and then I'm going to copy a couple of things from this. So activity, we shall say this is going to be Entebbe to Kampala, and this is just a city to city move. And then we shall say we'll provide you with lunch and dinner. And then in the PM, we'll say transfer from the airport to Kampala, transfer from Entebbe to Kampala. And then I'll add, of course, it's going to be 1 hour. And then overnight, I'll say stay at the Grand Emperor Hotel. And that will be all the information that I need to add here. So I'll click update for this and we'll stick with this. Let's now add this information into our block right here. So I'm going to go back to our editor. I'll come to our travel block here, and we're going to realize that we need a couple of things to get our block moving. So I'm going to minimize the area we have here. I'll bring this in so that I can see what I am dealing with. And then we're going to have a couple of things. So in this little area, we have a span. That span will be the one that has the day one. We're going to have our image. And the image will actually have a source. So I'll put source and have that here. We're going to have a div with a class of content info. And then we're going to have this part where the services are. So I'm going to display this and say this is going to be services info. So services info. And the one thing that I'm going to do is, since this has a border, I'm just going to wrap everything here in a div, and then I'll call this the travel-it block. I'll press enter, and then I'll run everything else inside this, because at some point we're going to have to write some CSS for this, but we need to determine our HTML at this particular point. So we have the span of day one, we have our image, we have our divs, we have our services. So after doing this, we're going to go back into our documentation of the ACF blocks, and you'll see that they give you all this information that you can actually pick from here, but I'm going to use it to get just a couple of things. So I'll just copy from here to about the part where we get our information from the fields, and I'm going to paste it here, and I'll explain what's going on. Now I'll remove this PHP line that is duplicate and allow us to have something that's usable. And what I'm going to do now is explain to you what this first comment means. And I'll do that by opening up my editor. So when I come back to my editor, of course I'm going to right click this block so that you can see the attributes we're going to talk about. And when I go to its root, you're going to see that it has a block ID with this information, it has a class, it has all this different information like the area label and all the data type and all this information that comes from Gutenberg or the block editor itself. And then you will see that we have the ACF component and the ACF body. Now that's something introduced by our ACF plugin. And then we have the preview, then we have our block here, the HTML that we have written. But all this information, we don't see it, and that information ACF passes it to us using this block variable right here. So let's get this variable and then we're going to dump it and see what exists inside it. So I'll paste it in there and then I'm going to save this. I'll reload what we have here. And when you look at that, you're going to see that we have all this information inside that array. We have the name, the title of the block, the description, the category, icons, keywords, the post type, the render template, the callback, and all this information from this particular block. So you can actually have all this information and dump it in your block if you need to use it. But I just wanted to show you this so that you can understand what this comment is all about. Then we have the content that's also exposed to us through the ACF API. We have the preview, and then we can also get the post ID of where this block is. And I cannot think of any way to use this post ID unless we wanted to get like the title of this page and then add it to our blog. For example, you would say maybe echo, and then you're going to say get the title. And then inside that, you're going to pass this post ID that ACF is exposing to us, and then add a semicolon. Let's save this, come back here, let's reload. And then you'll be able to see the post or the name of this post right here. So you can use that as part of your block. But we don't need to use this information right now. So what I'm going to do is just remove all of this. And then we can start building our block using what we really need. I hope that gives you a clear picture of the information that you have available coming from ACF, which you can pass down into your block. So the first thing that we do is that if we want our block to have an ID for storage of information, for styling, we can do that. So I'm going to change this and the class name as well. I'm going to change them to travel it dash block. And then of course it will have a dash and then it will add on the ID of the block. So if the ID is actually empty, then we shall have something that's given by default to give us an ID. And then we shall have a class name that we're going to attach to our block. So we're going to have this travel it block as the class name of our block. We'll actually get this class name and we're going to append a space to it, and then we're going to append the class name from the block itself. Now, one of the things that you see as you use the blocks is that they have alignment. We have left, right, center, wide width and full width, and those can actually be picked up, and that's where we're using them in this section. So we shall be able to get the alignment as well. And then the next thing that we're going to do is that we start picking the fields that we registered in our block right here, and then we're going to get them for the individual blocks to get this information right here. So for my first field, the name that I used here is called daytime. So I'll come here and I'll have my daytime is actually going to equal to get the field, which is called daytime. So I'll just remove all of this and say our field is called daytime. So I'll duplicate this line so that we can get all the other fields that have been assigned and also store them inside their own variables. I'll copy this as well, image, go back and add it here. And then I'm going to come back and get the day's activity as well, store it in a variable. And then I'll get the service, which is a group, and you'll see how we shall handle that. So let's first get it in here. And then we're going to get the aim description, which is a text area. Then I'll get the PM description as well. And then I'll get the overnight information also, and we'll dump it where it needs to be. So we have the overnight, we have it here. So let me just clean this out so that I have something easier to read. I'll just add spaces which don't affect the language at all. Nothing happens. This just makes it easier for me to read and a little bit easier on the eye for you as well. So now I'm going to escape PHP. So now we're going to change this class into something that's dynamic. We also are going to add an ID that's also going to be dynamic. And I'm just going to pick the ID from here and the class name from here as well. So I'll come down here. I'll open up my PHP tags. And then I'm going to say echo, and I'll use the WordPress escape attribute, which is basically a function that helps you clean up texts and strings, and then gives you something without things that can be pushed into your database or to your user, and they are harmful. So I'm going to also escape here and I'll say add the class name as well. Now the next thing we need to do is add the daytime. So I'll copy this as well, change it here, and then I'll pass in the daytime, which is a text. And then for our image here, I'm going to do something that's a little bit different. I'm going to copy this, I'll comment out this image, and I'm going to dump what we get from our image. So I'll copy this, dump, change this, and this is not going to be a string. It's actually going to be a blast of information that will be dumped on the front end. So we'll push this down there, and then I'm going to get the day's activity, pass it here in the content. So this is going to be something that's a little bit different. So we'll get the day's activity, AM, PM, and overnight. So I'll just copy those. I'm going to drop them here. I'm going to choose this information here. I will paste it before the title, and then I'll close off the PHP as well after the title. Now this allows me to actually wrap this in a paragraph if I need to, or in any other kind of markup. So I'll duplicate this over so that we can have the AM description as well here, we can have the PM here, and then the overnight as well here. And then the only thing that's left is for the available service, which we're going to add in our services info. So I'll copy this right here, I'll paste it in here, and then I'm going to get available service, and then I'll just echo it out because it's going to be an array of information. I'll echo it out that way. So let me remove this, and then I'll change this to print R because it's an array, it's not a string. We don't want to have any kinds of issues, so I'll print R that, and then I'm also going to print R our image as well. I'll save this, let's go back, let's look in our post, we're going to reload it, and you're going to see our information is actually showing up here, basing on what we have here. So if I change this to 2, you'll see that it automatically changes to 2 here. If I had another block, and say let me add another travel itinerary, you'll see that we have this block here. And then I'm going to change this to 3. If I choose to say let's have the dinner, breakfast, and everything, you'll see that our array shows each one of those with a 1 right here. The only thing that we are not seeing is the image, and we don't have an image here because we've not actually loaded one. So I'll click add image. I'm going to just drag and drop something from, and you see that when I select this, and on adding that image, you'll see that we actually have an array of data showing up here. It gives us the title, it gives us the file name, the size, the link, which is the URL, we get the author, we get all different kinds of information on this. And that's information we can actually throw in our HTML and have it working very well. So in here, I'm going to get the URL, I'm also going to get the title, and I'll pass the title for our SEO, or I can actually use the alt tag from here. I'm going to get the alt tag, I'm going to get the URL, I'll come back here, I'll undo this. So I'm going to copy this echo from here, put it in our source here, and say we want to get the image. And on the image, we actually want to get the URL. And then I'm going to copy this as well. I'll come here at the alt tag, I'm going to change this to the alt. And then we don't need a source set right now, but the source set is actually available right here. And if you want to get something that's close to what we have in WordPress, you can actually just ignore this. You'll open up your PHP in here, and then you'll say echo WP get attachment, and then you'll say attachment image. And inside here, you need to pass the attachment ID, which you can actually get from the image ID. So copy, paste the ID in here, and then you'll add a comma, and then you'll add the size of the image you want. So you can say full, and that is all you need to have here. I'll comment out the print R because we don't need it anymore. I'm going to reload here and you'll see that we have our image showing up here. And also on our side here, you're going to see that we actually see our image right here. And if I want, I can actually remove this, which I'll add, and you'll see that this image is actually showing up here. The only thing that we are left with in all of this is actually just to style up our code. So I'm going to go back to my editor. I'll reduce this a bit so that I can see what's going on. And inside here, I'm going to create a new folder, which I'll call assets. And inside assets, I'm going to have a new folder, which I'll call CSS. I'll have a new file inside that CSS called style.css. Now, the reason I'm going to have one style sheet for both of these, because you can defer whether you want something to only be on the front end, on the back end, but I'm going to have one CSS file to make this look like what we want to have on the front end. And it will be the same thing that we have on the back end. So once we have this style sheet, we just need to hook it inside our block right here. In order to add our CSS file to our PHP right here, we're actually going to use something called enqueue assets, enqueue underscore assets, and that uses a function in here. And in here, you can actually add all your CSS, all your JavaScript. It doesn't matter which JavaScript you're using or CSS. It could be from a pre-built service. Maybe you're trying to build a block that has graphs and so on, and there's this beautiful script you saw. You can import that and make sure that you have the right HTML structure to help you to unpack that inside your block. So inside here, I'm going to do a WP enqueue, and I want to enqueue style in here, and it expects a handle, which is going to be Travel IT Block. And then the next thing we shall do is we need to add the particular file where this plugin is actually set. So I'm going to do something similar and say plugin underscore directory underscore URL. And that's going to allow us to use the file constant. And that, of course, will give us the location of this file via URL. And we just need to go next to the assets. So this will be in assets. And then I'm going to go to CSS, then I'll add style.css. And once we do that, I need to add a semicolon at the end here so that I don't have the errors showing up. We can add the dependencies if we have any dependencies. We can add whether this has a version, and we can say maybe this is version 1 to match our plugin version. So here it expects to have the different media types. So I can say all, or I can say tablet or desktop or media or whatever, but I'm going to choose for all because that's what I want to have. I'm going to right click on this block and inspect it. And you're going to see that we have the ID here, and then we have Travel It Block. And that's what we're going to use to style in here. So I'll say we're looking for the class Travel-it-block. And then I'm going to give this a border of 2 pixels, solid. And I'm going to say it's going to be a lime green. I'll save this. Let's go back and see whether this is actually applying. So I'll reload here. We'll see that we have our lime green here. And that means we can add all the other missing styles to make this work out. So the next thing that I'm going to do is just have this here. I'll reduce this portion so that I can clearly see what I'm styling and have something that is more complete in a look. I'm going to take a mental picture of what I have here. I'm going to just roll this down a little bit so that I can be able to follow through as I see what I'm doing here as well. So I'll also go ahead and minimize this so that I have my block fully showing up here. And then I'll drag this up so that I maximize the size of my screen to see my block, to see my sketch, and also to see my code. So let's kick this off. Number one, this green that we have here, that's lime, is not the best. So we're going to have a green here. So I'll change this to green, number one. Then number two, we are going to have about four different sections. So we have section one with our day, section two with the image, three with all this code, and finally four with our breakfast, lunch, and dinner showing up right here. Now, all I need to do is use grid, and I'm going to say display grid to have that, and then I'll use a grid template columns. And in this space, I'm going to have something that's a little bit different. So the first thing that I'll do is I'll say, let this be 20 pixels for the first section. The next section will be 200 pixels for our image. Then we're going to have one FR to get all the remaining space for this middle section. And then finally, we're going to select this be auto so that this auto sizes itself. And if I save that, come back here and reload, you will see that we are now starting to have something as close as to what we have here, but of course it still has its issues. So let's start off with the day item, and you realize that these spaces are all collapsing inside each other. They are squeezed tightly. So I'm going to have what we call a grid gap of about 20 pixels to make that better. So if I reload this here, you'll see that the space that we have here is actually much better than what we had before. So that's starting to look nice as we want it to. So the next thing we're going to do is work with this day item. And I'm going to just go back here and look at the HTML. And you're going to see that we have this div here and we have this span. I'm going to attach a class to this span and I'll call it day, just to be very, very particular about my CSS that it's going only to this block. I'll add it here and I'll say, let's go for that day. And then we're going to style that span. In fact, we can even just say here span, just to be so clear. This span needs some border radius, it needs some background and the change in color so that it looks like what we have here. We're going to give it a display of inline block, because a span by default has only inline for display. That means you cannot give it a height, you cannot give it different properties that you would give to a div. So declaring it to be inline block will allow us to treat it like it's a div. So after doing that, I'm going to say we need to text align and say that will be center. And the next thing we're going to do is give this a padding of about 12 pixels on all sides. And then the next thing we'll do is we'll give this a background, and the color will be a green, just to match what we have here. And after doing that, we need to give it a color for the text and say, let this be white. After giving it a white color for text, the next thing we'll do here is I'm going to give it a height of 60 pixels, and then I'll give it a width of 60 pixels similarly. And the reason I'm trying to do that is just to get a square. So let me just save this and we preview what we've so far done. And you'll see we have this square here with the text, and that is showing up nicely. So all I need to do right now is actually say, let's give this a border radius of 100%, and that will make it look like a circle. So on reload, it will now look like a circle, which is neatly done. So the next thing we'll do is just say, let this come off the top. So we're going to give it a margin dash top, and we're going to give it something of 40 pixels. Then I'm going to say, let's give this a margin left, because we want to transfer it a little bit to the left. We're going to give it a minus 50, and I'll actually make it minus 60 so that it balances out in the middle, right on this border, like what we have here. So let me save this and reload. And we've gone off a little bit, we've gone way, way, way off. So I'll change this to minus 30, so that we are not taking it, we just want to meet it halfway. And voila, very nicely done. 30 is 50% of this particular diameter, so we are doing that properly. I'm just going to increase this to 70, because I want to have that word all in one line. So I'll do this and reload. And maybe I'll just add a padding top to that particular place. So I'll copy this, make sure everything else is 12, 18 pixels. And I think we now have it where we want it to be. It's in the right place. So we have this the way we want it to look like for now. And now I'm going to focus on this particular image. So I'll come back to our HTML, have a look at it. And I see we have so many things that are locked in here. So I'll remove all those things that have been commented out, like this print R. I'm going to give this its own container. And also I'm going to call this div with image. And then I'll push this PHP inside here. And then I can go to my styles and actually add it here. So I'll copy this travel it block. And then I'll say if we go to a div with img as a class, we can actually give this a display of block. And then after doing that, we can give it a width of 200 pixels and also a height of 200 pixels to be very exact. And then we can just say if we have any overflow, we can hide it. And after doing that, we now want to style this image so that it's square in nature. So to do that, I need to just duplicate this right here. And so we're going to target the image that's inside this class. So this image will get the display block of this, we'll give it the height and the width. And right here, we're going to say, let this have an object fit. And we're going to say, let it cover. And I'll save this. I'll come back here and reload. And you'll see that our image gets this square feel right here. So we're having that square and it's as neat as we wanted it to be. So the next thing that I need to work on, but we see that our space is sort of disappearing here because our little span right here is actually going off the center. So I'm just going to go back to span day and then I'm going to look for a margin left. I'll give this a 35 because that's half, and then this can still be 30. I think we changed the wrong value. So I'll reload this. Yeah, it's now more center and giving the space off here. I think we can now increase our grid gap and say let this be 30 and then tweak it. And that's the thing about CSS. You can never get it right the first time. So you sometimes have to keep on trying over and over and over again until you get it right. So I think we are now at a place where we are happier. So the next thing that I'll do is go to this content info, and I'm going to just copy this. I'll come back here, I'll duplicate this, and then I just want to get a few things off here. So content info. And with the content info, I think everything looks almost just about right, apart from the font weight, font-weight. And I'm going to go for something like 100 because it's very light in nature. I'll save that. Now, if you look here, you'll realize that we don't have the AM, we don't have the PM, we don't have the night and overnight showing up here. So we need to fix that. So I'm going to come back here and I'm going to add some little content here. The first thing is the title, the next thing is the AM, then we have the PM, then we have the overnight here. So I need to just wrap this with a strong tag. I'll close the strong tag. And we just need to get this and duplicate it over in the different places. So I'll paste it here and here, and then we change this to PM. I'll change this to overnight. Save this, and then if we come back here and reload, you'll see that we have that thin font lettering and we have our AM and PM just showing up nicely here. So I can just give this a little bit of space and that will be as good as we want it to be. Now I'm going to focus on this area now where we have the breakfast, lunch and dinner. And that's sort of the part that is a little bit tricky. I'm going to first style it with this default HTML that's there. And after doing that, then I'll introduce our dynamic content coming from our block. So number one, this span can have a class of unavailable. And then these others can have a class of available, because we see them when they're green right here, means they're available. If they're unavailable, then it's gray. So I'm going to remove this and just leave this for now. And then I'm going to come back to my style and I'm going to get the services info. So I'll copy this, come back here, duplicate this, of course, change this to services info, remove the extra space right here. I'll move this a little bit up so that I have all this space to work with. So the first thing that I'll do here is I'm going to change the font size, and I'll say let this be about 0.85 rem, save that, and then I'll give this a margin of 0, 0, and I'll give this 10 pixels at the bottom, then I'll have another 0, just to control what we have here for the paragraphs. So I'll reload this, and you'll see that this is a little bit thinner as we have here, and that is brilliant, that's doing it very well. Now I can also add a border, border dash left, and I can say let's have the same border like what we had here. So solid, 2 pixels, and it's going to be green. So I'll save this and then come back and reload. And you'll see that it starts all the way from up, but it never gets down here, which is a bit of a pain. We need to find out why that is. So I'm going to click on this to inspect. I'll drag this a little bit up. And when we look at services info, we actually find that there's a little bit of margin up here, which we want to remove. So this margin is doing us the disservice, so I'll just make this 0 all through. So when we save and come back here and reload, you'll see that it's actually doing so well. It's exactly as we pictured it. So I just need to do a couple of things, like give this a padding in here and say let's give this a padding of 20 pixels. I'll just look at what we have here in the grid. I'll say 30, let's give it a 30 and save, come back and reload. And this is looking nice, apart from this going from the top. I'll say it's 0 while the rest are 30. I'll come back here and reload, and you'll see that we have that nice 30 all across the board, which is looking nice. This is really what we wanted. Now I'm going to work with these little buttons, or what you see as balls here. Now in our HTML, we've just made them spans with a class of unavailable and a class of available, which is actually just sufficient. So we're going to play around with some grid, CSS grid, to make sure that they're all in line, just like these words are in line, and then everything else will be sweet and looking good. So now that we know that there are paragraphs in here, what I'm going to do is just duplicate this and then go for the paragraph here, and then I'll say we need to display this as grid. And after doing that, I'm going to say let's use the grid template columns. And the template columns we want to have, we want to say the words can always take up as much space as they want. And for the little balls, we'll say let them auto-generate their own size. So we'll not see anything here for now, but let's go ahead and work on those spans. So I'll just duplicate this again. We have a span that comes after the paragraph, so I can actually make them immediate children or immediate descendants. And then after doing that, I'm going to say it needs a width of 8 pixels. We'll also duplicate this and make a height of 8 pixels. That is the size of the span we want. Now remember that our span actually has a display of inline, so we're going to say let that be display of flex. And the reason we choose flex is that we want to use the align self and say center. So we want to make sure that everything in here is actually centered. Now, the next thing that we shall do is we're going to give this a background, and the background is going to be a light gray. So I'll save this. Let's come back here and reload, see what we have. You will see that we now have a little box, and with that box, we can actually say we need to give it a border radius of 100%. If we save this and come back and see what happens, you'll see that now they become little circles. Now I just need to push them off the words because I don't want them to be so close, and I'll say margin dash left. For now, let's say it's 20 pixels just to push them away. On reload, you'll see that we have that, and it's getting there. It's almost what we want it to be. You realize that there's a little bit of a border right here. So I'm going to give this item a border of 2 pixels. I'll say that's going to be solid, and I'll say that needs to actually be transparent. And the reason I'm saying transparent is because we have this little bit of like white color in between after the circle. So we need to give this that border of 2 pixels and allow it to just go off. Now we're going to use some pseudo elements with this to make this come off and get this extra border of this green. So the first thing that I will do here is I'll say that this has a position of relative, and why that has relative is because I'm now going to have something that is positioned absolutely. So I'll remove this and I'll say the next item is going to be absolutely positioned, and that is going to be the after. And we're going to give it a content, and the content is actually going to be a space because we want to give it that. And the next thing we want to do is we want to give this a border of 2 pixels solid, and it's going to be green. I'm going to save this for now. Let's see what happens. You'll see that we have that green that is square in here, but we need to take it off and pull it all the way out. So I'm going to actually have some top, left and bottom. So I'll have top, and I'll say let's pull this 8 pixels away. We're going to do the same thing for left, right and bottom. So let me duplicate this and then just change these properties. So we have top, left, top, right, left, and then we need to have bottom as well. So if I save this and then come and reload, you'll see that now we have that square box that has been pulled away and pulled out. And the only thing we need to do here is just come and say we need to have a border radius of 100%. So after our border here, I'll say border radius 100%, reload this, and then you'll see that we have that nice curve showing up on our little button. You can say we are almost getting there. So I'll just reduce this border radius or border radii, whatever the plural is. I'm going to reduce them to 1 so that we can have something thin like what we have in our design. And that's looking much, much better. And I realized that I pulled this off a little bit too far. So let me adjust this to about 6 pixels. When I save this and reload, you're going to have it perfect, just perfect. Now there's only one thing left to do. I need to change so that when we have available as the option, this is green. So I'm going to come to the span here and then I'll say, we'll get the span and we shall add a class available to it. And all we want to do is just say, let the background, like we gave this background here of gray, let's have a background of green. That's the only thing that's going to change. So I can take away all these other rules, even this border radius, and just have green in there. So that when we reload, we actually have the greens showing up right like what we have here. So we are at that place where we feel comfortable with the design of our block. I now need to just make a few things that are dynamic so that when we don't have AM, we don't have AM showing up here. When we do have it, then we can have the PM, we can have the overnight showing up. And then I need to also do some dynamic content to show these pieces of icons when we have available. So we just add a class of available, and then that will become green on its own. I'm going to leave the CSS file and I'll focus on the PHP right here. So in order to make sure that the M is only showing if it is available and it's filled, we have to run some PHP. So I'm going to open up some PHP tags here, and then I'll add PHP. And then I'm also going to run some tags down here, because at the end of the day, we're going to be putting an if statement for this code. So I'm going to say right here in my PHP, if our condition that we set is met, then let's run this, and then we shall close off to stop that if statement from running. And the condition we are looking for is if this AM is actually not empty. So I'll say not empty, and I'll open our brackets and say if the AM is not empty, then we should run this code. Or if there's something else, then we shouldn't run that code. So I'll save that, I'll come back here and reload. And you see we don't have the AM showing up here. So basically, we're just going to do the same thing for all the other pieces. So I'll just duplicate this, and we're going to get the PM description and just change it in this location. And here, I'll change this to PM, so that is exactly what we have here. And then I'll duplicate this as well for overnight, and say, let's get our overnight key showing up here, get this overnight showing up in this location and this location. Then I'll remove this, we don't need it. And then I can do the same thing also for our activity title, so that it doesn't feel left out or we don't make a mistake. So I'll cut this, remove these paragraphs, and then I'll just paste it here to say if our title is actually available, then we should echo this out. So and save that, let's go and see that we don't have any errors apart from the paragraph tags that we took away. So I need to add this back, I'll reload, and then we have that neat and clean as we had before. So the content info is done, it's dynamic, this is done, it's dynamic, this is done, it's dynamic. Now the only thing we are left to do is actually have this breakfast. So we are going to use the same idea that we have here, and we're going to paste it down here. And in this case, we're going to do something different. I'm going to uncomment this out so that you see what we get for available service. And I'm going to reload. And you'll see that we get an array with the breakfast and the lunch. And whenever that is available, we have a 1 right here. So it's sort of saying it's true. So we're going to say we're going to look for available service, and on that array we're going to look for the breakfast item inside that array, and we're going to say if the available breakfast service is actually equal to 1. So we'll say equal to 1. I'm going to just remove this and just keep on writing the PHP in this space so that we have it running as one variable. So I'll say the class, if our service breakfast is equal to 1, then our class that we are going to set is actually going to equal to available. So I'll copy this and I'll say the class will equal to available. If it is not, else the class is actually going to equal to unavailable. So I duplicate this, move this down and say it will be unavailable. And then I add semicolons to this. Now, this is a bit lengthy, and we can actually make it into something that's short. And the way we do that is we're going to get this and say, if our breakfast is equal to 1, then we're going to say the class is equal to available. So I'll copy this and say is equal to available, else the class is going to equal to unavailable right here. After doing that, the only thing we need to do is actually come in here and write some PHP and say PHP, and we're going to echo And the one thing we want to do here is we want to get the class. And I'll put a semicolon and save this. So if we come back here, I'm going to just comment out this print R, just so that we don't see it anymore. I'll save this, I'll come back here and reload. And you're going to see the breakfast is actually unavailable. So I'll just inspect this to make sure. If I go in this paragraph, you're going to see it's unavailable because we actually don't have that on our block. So I'll open this up and you'll see that our service is not ticked. If we tick it, then it becomes green. If we uncheck it, then it becomes gray. So it's working exactly as we wanted it to be. So I'm going to do the same thing for all the other pieces. So I'm going to make this rule work out the same for all the other pieces. So I'm going to remove this shorthand because we don't need it. So the only thing now I can do is just say breakfast, lunch, so B class, and then B class here. And then I'll differentiate this by duplicating it here. And I'll say lunch in this case. And I need to make this L class, and then I'll copy this right here, paste it in this location, and then I'll say L class. Just to check for our lunch, I'll come back here and reload. And you'll see that works out well. If I click on this block, go and change the lunch, that also ticks it off. Tick it, that makes it available. So we just need to do the same thing here. I know this is not the most optimum of ways, but it makes it very easy to do. Then after making sure that our concept is right or is working well, then we can optimize the way we've made it to work. So let's first find our dinner. I'll save this. We have the D class there. I'll remove this because we don't need it anymore. And then I'm going to come back here, I'll reload. You will see that our breakfast is not available. Tick lunch off. Lunch is not there. Dinner is not there. Dinner is on. Breakfast is on. Lunch is on. That's all okay. If I go and add another block right here, it will also have its own settings. I can say lunch is available. And you'll see that's working the way it should be. And you'll see that we don't have any statements here because we have not added any of those statements in these other locations. So this block is working very, very well as we expected it to be. And you can see this will save me from making so many post types and just allow me to have, let's say, my Safari, and I'm having the different itineraries and I'm just putting these as blocks. If I update this, save it, go and view my front end, and I'll open it up in a new page. And when it loads, you'll actually see that we have our block working here, but I need to just fix a couple of things because this particular theme is interacting with this and changing it. So let me try a different default theme just to show you that the theme is the one that usually affects all those things. If I add the 2021 and then come here and reload this, you'll see that themes in particular ways interact with all our code differently. So I might have to do just a couple of touches to make sure that everything is actually working the way it should be. Now, Gutenberg or the block editor is not yet the perfect what you see is what you get kind of editor. And that's why we have a mismatch with what we have on the front end here and what we have in the back end. So even if I try to change this to align center, align left, and so on, I'll get something different from here with what I see on the front end. So that's why usually you have two different style sheets to do something from the back end and what you get on the front end. But in this particular case, you just need to fix what's on the front end because the back end is really not what your customers end up seeing. Now, finally, I want to share something with you about ACF. Now, if we happened to go to our fields, I'm going to leave this page and I'll go to the custom fields here. If someone actually went to the edit here, let's say they were an administrator and they happened to turn this off and say update. Let's say they deactivate this. If you actually went and tried to add a new block here, you're going to realize that you don't have those settings showing up here. Now, ACF allows you to have these particular settings in your PHP. And how do we do that? So before we deactivate this, I'm going to activate it once again. I'm going to go to the tools here. And in the tools, I can select the block I want and I'll say generate PHP. And that will give us this PHP which we can actually copy, then go back to our code inside our block here. And we're going to say, we want to actually have this code running down here. So I can paste it here. And then I can say, I need this code to run. So I'm going to have another action hook that's going to run this code. So I can actually just say, let this be in a function, which I'm going to call. I'll copy what we have here, techiepress ACF block. So function that, and I'm going to say settings at the end, and I'll add this as a function of its own. I'm going to just get all of this, tap this inside, and then I'll close off that function. The code is still here. I just wrapped it with my editor. So we have this. So I'm going to just copy this name of this function, come back here, I'll create a new hook called init, and then I'll pass these settings here. Now the only thing that I can do differently is I can set this with a higher priority of 9, and then say let those settings come in at 10. So we register the block first, then we get the settings coming in. So I'll save this. I'm going to come back here and go back to the fields. I'll edit the fields, and I'm going to disable them, and I'll hit update here. And you realize if I reload this page, and then I select any of these settings are here. If I choose to add a new block, you'll see that these settings are also here. So this is the best way to protect yourself by having these in PHP. You can actually even download these settings and save them in a file somewhere else. So if you go to tools, you can just select this, and then you export the file and save that JSON so that in any other time, you can actually import it through this browser here. So that's how you can transfer your block settings from one site to another, or you can save yourself the pain of someone having deactivated the field groups or deleted them, and yet you have those blocks running on the website. So you can protect yourself by having that code down here. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. If you learned something new or you want to learn something new, don't forget to leave me a comment down below. Share this video with your friends, with your other developers. Let them know what's happening here. Otherwise, enjoy whatever you're building and don't stop building good stuff.